Good morning, everyone. In the previous class, we studied about the inverting kind of Schmitt trigger circuit design. Okay, and we started somehow like how we can design the non-inverting kind of Schmitt trigger design as well. So let us try to briefly discuss again how we can design the non-inverting Schmitt trigger circuit and how it looks like and how it works actually. Okay, so let us see, or let us start with this one. So we started our analysis like, yeah, this is the simple inverter circuit, and we know that the characteristics of simple inverter is like, suppose if I'm changing the input from low to high or high to low, then the output will be changed accordingly. Like it will act like a simple inverter. Like if the input is lower than the threshold voltage of this circuit, or the mid voltage of this inverter circuit, in that case it will start switching. So there will be some switching from high to low or high to low, and that depends on the circuit property. Okay, so this is what we know about this simple inverter circuit. Now if we talk about how we can make the Schmitt trigger, I just told you in the previous class, like the Schmitt trigger circuit is basically utilized if we want to make our circuit noise tolerant. Okay, so if there is some presence of noise in the input and we want to avoid those noises, so there may be some range which can be utilized. Like if there is a noise within a range, so that will be suppressed, and at the output we will not get anything, and that range is basically decided by the hysteresis width. Okay, so this is the thing which we have already studied in the previous class. Now, in the previous class, we were talking about the inverting kind of Schmitt trigger circuit. Now, here we will talk about the non-inverting. So let us see how we can make it. Okay, so for that purpose, what we have to do, we have to use one more arrangement, something like this, one inverter kind of arrangement. In opposite direction, but yeah, if we closely see this one after implementing this kind of arrangement, these two transistors, like this transistor and these transistors, just look like a lever restorer. Okay, when this transistor, if M1 transistor is activated, in that case this will restore the logic for high one. Okay, so if M4 is activated, in that case this will see here, if I have 0, then it will be 1, it will give 0. Okay, so this 0 will try to activate this transistor M4, and if this M4 is activated, so that will that will keep pulling the value whatever we have here. Okay, so this is important. Similarly, like if the output is 1, in that case this transistor M3 will be activated, and this transistor M3 that will be responsible in the pulling down the things. Okay, so this is what we already know, how we can decide all those things. Now let us try to see how this circuit will work. Okay, so we can have a two possible cases. Like if I'm changing the input from 0 to high, this is the first case, and the second case could be like if I'm changing the input from high to low. Okay, so let us consider the first case. If I am changing the input from low to high. Okay, so if I'm changing the input from low to high, means I'm changing some, like the input pattern is something like this one. So if, let us assume during the initial phase of transition, I'm considering the input is equal to 0. If input is equal to 0, the output of this first inverter or this input inverter, this will be 1. We have added one more inverter over here. So the output of the second inverter, that will give 0. So whatever the input we have, that will be reflected at the output. Okay, so we will get the same, in means output and output will be matched, both will be same. Now let us try to see. So if the input is equal to 0, in that case M2 is in the on state and M1 is in the off state. Okay, now let us try to see what happens with the transistor M4 and M3 which we have connected externally. Okay, because the output as logic 0, this will activate this transistor M4. Okay, and if this transistor M4 is activated, and here if you see, M3 will not be activated. Okay, so If you see, like the device transconductance ratio, we know that device transconductance ratio is nothing but this is given by Kn upon Kp, Kn upon Kp. Okay, this is the ratio of Kn upon Kp. Kn is nothing but this is, but we have we already know this is the mu n Cox W by L of nMOS, and similarly this Kp will be the mu p Cox W by L of this PMOS transistor. So this is what the device transconductance ratio is, which we know that. Now let us take a, let us consider the inputs what where we have considered. When the input V in that basically rises from 0 to VDD, this transistor M4 will effectively that will be that will be in parallel with this transistor M2, because this is an activation mode. And because this M2 and M4 are connected in parallel, that will reduce this KR, because effectively this KP will increase. And if KP is increases, what it means this KR will reduce. Okay. So the KR of this input inverter, that will reduce if both M2 and M4 are in on state. Okay, so the effectively KR of the input inverter, that will reduce. Okay, on the other hand, if you see, like if I'm changing the input from high to low, okay, so yeah, simply let me write some cases here and there, so that will be better. So if V in is changing from 0 to VDD, in that case, the KR of the input inverter, that will reduce. Okay, so the KR will reduce. Okay, because yeah, so let me write one more thing, like the M2 is parallel with the M4, and because of that, this will effectively reduce the KR. Now let us talk about the second case. If the input is changing from VDD to zero. Okay. So the, if input is changing from VDD to zero, what will happen? Let us see. Let us assume initially the input was at high. So the, if the input is at high potential. So let us assume this is one. Yeah, let me change the color. So that will be better. Yeah. So let us consider the input is one. In that case, output will be zero. Output of the input inverter will be zero. And because the output of input inverter is zero, the output of the second inverter, that will become one, which is same as the input one. And if the V output is equal to one, in that case, transistor M3 will be activated. And yeah, so because the input was one, V in was one, so M2 was in the off state, M1 will be in the on state. Okay, and because the V output is one, this will activate transistor M3, and the transistor M4 will be in the off state. So now in this case, transistor M1 and M3 will be in the parallel. Okay, so M1 will be in parallel with M3, and because of that, what will happen? Because the M1 and M2 are in the parallel, the effectively Kn will increase. And if the Kn is increasing, what it means, the Kr will also increase. So the Kr is going to increase this one. So this is what the cases we have. Okay, I will have one diagram over here. So I think I need to write somewhere here and there. Okay. So let me write cases here. If V in is changing from 0 to VDD, in that case, M2 will be in parallel with M4, and that will effectively reduce the KR. And the second case is if V in changing from VDD to zero, then M1 will be in parallel with M3, and that will effectively increase the KR. Okay. Okay. So If we are considering like this, like the effective device transconductance ratio is increasing and decreasing based on the activation of these transistors, so how the waveform will look like? Yeah, this is the input. So the first case, like we consider, like input is changing from 0 to VDD. So because KR is decreases, KR of the input inverter decreases, what it means, the transition will be faster, means that will so here we have like that, it will reduce the threshold voltage, right? So because we have decreased this KR, and that will lead to decrease the threshold voltage of this logic or this circuit, this inverter. This threshold voltage is nothing but this is the voltage at which the input and output are crossing to each other, right? So this is not equal to threshold voltage of the transistor. This is equal to the threshold voltage of the device, this inverter. So this particular threshold voltage will reduce, because effectively, if we see M2 and M4 both are activated, so we will have a strong pull-up. And if we have a strong pull-up, then the threshold voltage will reduce, means the output voltage will reach at high voltage early, because we have a strong pull-up network, because of M2 and M4 both are in on state. Okay, so if we'll increase the input from 0 to VDD, in that case M2 and M2 are in on state, and we will have a strong pull-up network. And if we have a strong pull-up network, means the change in logic will be early, so the threshold voltage will be reduced. If we talk about other cases, in other case, like if input is changing from high to low, in that case the pull down network will become stronger. And if the pull down network will become stronger, what it means, the output will be pulled to the logic low early, so means in that case the threshold voltage will be higher. So the threshold voltage, that simply depends like what is the strength of pull-up network and the pull-up network and the pull-down network of any inverter which we want to plot. Okay, so this is how this particular circuit works, and this is how it behaves. Okay, so we have a two different potentials. So the threshold voltages, this is the VTH, and another one is the VTL. Okay. So this is all about the non-inverting kind of Schmitt trigger. Okay, so the important thing is, like, see, if I am talking about the zero to high change, in that case M2 and M4 will be responsible, and for low to high, M1 and M3 will be responsible. Accordingly, pull up and pull down strength will change, and because of that pull up and pull down strength, KR will change, and because of this change in KR, threshold voltage of the circuit will also change, at least there will be switching, so that will also change, and that will give you some hysteresis kind of properties. Oh, so this is what we have, the hysteresis width. Important thing about this one is, like, if somehow we try to manage, or we try to optimize all these transistor sizing, so this hysteresis width can be adjusted. So what will be the hysteresis width? That completely depends on what is the sizing of this additional transistor M4 and M3. So see, if M4 is strong enough, in that case what will happen? Can anyone say where this waveform will shift? Let us assume if I'm increasing the size of M4, then where this blue waveform will shift, on the left side or in right side? Can anyone suggest? Okay, you are able to understand or not? I don't know. So basically, see, this M4 is in parallel with M2 when I'm changing the input from 0 to VDD. In that case, because it is making...
Sir, it will shift towards left, I think.
It will shift towards the left direction. Yes, this is true. Because see here, if we have increased the strength of M4, then it will effectively increase the strength of this pull-up network. What it means, the pull-up network is more stronger, and that will try to pull up the logic early. Okay, so this instead of taking too much voltages, it this will shift in this left direction. Okay, so if I'm changing the strength of M4, okay, so this will shift in this direction. Okay, so the shift will be in this direction. Similarly, if I'm changing the strength of M3, in that case, that will try to pull down as early. So this will be the direction for M3. So if I'm increasing the size of M3, in that case, the shift will be in this direction. So the hysteresis will depends on like what is the size of M4 and M3. So by adjusting the size of M3 and M4, we can change the hysteresis width. Okay. Fine. So this is all about the non-inverting Smith trigger circuit. Yeah, please.
So M2, M1 also can be changed.
Yes, M2, M1 is also important. Like that also that will reflect the effective transition. So M2 and M1 will also be responsible for that case, right? So yeah, you can also write here like if you are increasing the strength of M2, then this will also shift in this direction. And M1 will also be something like this. I just wrote because M4 and M3 are actually responsible to make to change the hysteresis. Otherwise, M1 and M2 are the normal the transistor for the inverter. That is why I did not consider. But yes, the sizing of M2 and M1 will also reflect on this hysteresis width. Okay, so this is also equally contributing components. Okay, so this is all about the non-inverting Smith trigger circuit. Now, let us try to recall a few things what we have done till now. Okay, till now we have studied several things related to like the two stable states, bistable states. So as I told you before, like we can have a sequential circuit of three types. Either we can have two stable states, or we can have one stable state. Okay. Or we can have none of the, no stable state, and that we call it the unstable. Okay, so the monostable kind of circuit we can have, the bistable kind of circuit we can have, or the unstable kind of circuit we can have. You may have already studied all these things in the analog electronics, right? So let us try to recall few things which are really important to understand the concept, and then we'll try to see what kind of circuits we have explained. So till now, what kind of circuit, like all the latches and other things which we have discussed, all this comes under the bistable state. Either we can have logic zero or we can have a logic one. Okay, so we have a bistable state, and the change in the state that completely depends on how we are forcing the input to change the output. Like we need to provide some force so that we can get the some change in the output. Okay, so this is what the bistable kind of logic is. So to understand the concept of other kind of configurations like a stable and the monostable, let us try to picturally demonstrate different kind of multivibrators. So the multivibrator is nothing but this is the we can have a three kind of the multivibrator. Either it could have a bistable, a stable, or the monostable multivibrator. Okay, so picturally, let us try to see. Suppose if I have a bistable kind of multivibrator, just like a SR latch. So if I will apply some force on the set, then this force will be like this source will be dominating. This will dominate. And if I will apply some input to the reset input, then this could be something like this. So this looks like a seesaw kind of thing, right? So which just kids used to do, like if this kid is forcing some putting some force, then it will come down and vice versa. This is what happens with the bistable. So it completely depends on where we are putting the force, where we are applying some force, and based on that we can decide what is the state as of now. Okay, so the state completely decided by the input whatever we have provided at both the inputs. Okay, so this is what we call the bistable multivibrator. Simple example of this bistable multivibrator is the flip-flop, Smith trigger, latches. So this all comes under the bistable multivibrator. Second kind of multivibrator we can have something like this one. Okay, suppose I have a spring, I have force some spring, and until I will apply some force on this one, this logic will be at logic low, and once we release this force, this will again settle down to the original position. So this will become like this one. Okay, so what it means, if you have applied some force, then it will change some logic, but after a certain period of time, it will come to its original position, like what was the position like this. So let us assume the initial position was something like this one. Okay, but if you have applied some force, then it will come down, this logic will come down, and once you release this force, that will come into the original phase. So this is what we call it, the monostable multivibrator. Okay, so until you have applied the force, this will change the logic, but once after a certain period of time, this will come back to its original position. Okay, so this is what the monostable multivibrator is, or we can also call it one shot multivibrator. Okay, third kind of configuration we can have, like the unstable multivibrator. Here we can have a two spring on both the side. Let us assume I have applied some force over here, and after applying this force, let us assume I have released this force. Then what will happen? This spring will expand and this will shrink or something like that. This will shrink, and on the second side, so both will like, there will be some oscillation kind of thing. Both spring will oscillate on both the directions. So we can have, like, there is no stable state. So we can call it the unstable multivibrator. And basically, these kind of concepts are utilized in the oscillators, where we want to make some oscillating, we want to generate some frequency. So for that purpose, we need to use this kind of circuit, which is a stable kind of multivibrators. Okay, so this is all the discussion about the multivibrators. So till now, we have studied about the flip-flop. Flip-flop is nothing, but we have already studied the latch. So that is the part of flip-flop, no problem. We have already studied the Schmitt trigger. So this is what we have done. Now let us try to study how we can design a one shot circuit based on the CMOS logic. Okay, so we know the concept of this monostable multivibrator. What is it means? Once you have applied some input, if we have triggered, then it will maintain a logic for some period of time, then it will come to its original position once that time period is finished. Okay, so this is the simple concept of the monostable multivibrator. Okay, so this is what we have to use. So let us try to consider one example of this monostable kind of circuitry. So we will consider like a transition triggered one shot circuit. Okay, so this, let us see how this circuit works. Yeah, so this is a simple schematic of one shot circuit, where we have a XOR gate. Okay, and here we have some delay component. We know that the property of XOR gate is like, if I have like, let us assume I have two inputs, so 0 0 0 1 1 0 and 1 1, this is a possible input combination for two input XOR gate, and the output will be high if any one of the input is high, right? So 0 1 1 0. So this is what the truth table of XOR gate is. Okay, so this is all about the XOR gate. Now let's talk about the delay TD. This delay TD decides like up to what time we want to change the state, whatever we have. Okay, so yeah, I will explain in this more detail what is the importance of this delay element. So this delay element basically provide the delay between this input and this input. Okay, so yeah, so because this input provided to this element, so this output will be received after time delay TD. Okay, so the output of this delay element will be received after time delay TD, and the same means what it means, the same input will be received after TD time. But if you see the second input we are receiving at t is equal to 0. Okay, so the input of this XOR gate is received at two different times. Okay, so if it is receiving two different times, like what it means, it can change some logic. Okay, so let us see how it will be changed. So to understand that one, Initially, let us consider the input of XOR gates are preset to zero. Okay, so the initially the input of this XOR gate is preset to zero. So here we have a zero, here we have a zero. Now I am changing input. Yeah, input is also zero, right? So if the input is equal to zero, so even though there is some delay, but I will get zero output after a certain period of time. So zero is there also. Okay, so what we have done, we have preset all the inputs to zero. Now what we are doing here, we are changing the input from logic zero to logic one. Okay, so if we are changing input from zero to one, so the transition at the output of this delay element will be received after TD time. Okay, but yeah, so let me write some inputs. Let us assume this is input A and this is input B. Okay, so the input A will receive this transition after TD. Okay, so let us assume this time is T is equal to zero. So this time will be T is equal to TD. Okay, so after TD time, the A will be reflected. But if we talk about this B will be received at the same time when we have applied the input. So this is nothing but this T is equal to zero. So until if we neglect the delay of this one, okay, we can include later on, but let us assume that by neglecting the delay of this XOR gate, at T is equal to zero, what I will get? I will get the, because before that input was zero, and because this was preset to zero, so input will again be zero. Okay, so the zero and zero input will be received. So logic low will be there. Okay, we will be having logic low. But once this input is triggered from low to high, this B will change from zero to high, but A will remain same until the time TD. Okay, so up to time TD, it will remain same. So because the B is changed from zero to one, now the logic will change because A is, it's still zero and B becomes one. So zero and one, that will give logic high at the output of this XOR gate. So we will get some logic high, something like this. And this logic high will be maintained until this A, like up to this time TD. So this time TD, after time TD, the input of A becomes this A becomes logic high. And if A becomes logic high, here we have high and the B is already in high state. So high and high, that will give you the logic low. So this kind of behavior. So we will observe at the output. So yeah, so this is how it will look like at the output. And here we will have some TD. So this pulse can be generated for the time period of TD. Okay, and once we have triggered the input, that output will be received for TD time delay. So what is the time duration of this pulse or this one? That completely depends on what kind of delay elements we have used here. So we can use any kind of circuit, if we have cascaded even number of inverters, so that will give you the additive delay of all the inverters, and delay TD can be generated. Okay, so this is all about the things which we should understand. Is there any doubt here? In case of any doubt, you may ask. Otherwise, we can move ahead with the next thing. Anyone? Okay. So this is really important to understand, how it is working. Okay, so I'm assuming you are able to understand the things. Either everything is clear or nothing is clear. So it's up to you what you have received. Okay, fine. So this is all about the one sort. So yeah, so this delay element could be anything. It's not necessary you have to add n number of inverters only, right? So you can add any of the circuit based on your requirement. You can adjust the sizing in a such a way that you are getting exact TD what you need. Okay, so that you can, this delay element can be designed by any of the circuits. Okay, so this is all about the one shot kind of circuit. Okay. Now, the third variant which we have studied, like the unstable kind of circuits. So let us see how we can design the unstable circuit. Unstable circuit means what? It means that there should be oscillation, right? So how we can decide the unstable kind of circuit? Let us try to. So one of the biggest, like one of the most well-known example is the ring oscillator. You have already studied in the digital system, digital designing, right? So ring oscillator you have studied. So how this ring oscillator works, how we can design based on the CMOS logic, we will study over here. But before I explain how we can design the ring oscillator, let me explain the concept of oscillator. Okay, so the concept of oscillator is equally important before knowing the ring oscillator. So how we can make the oscillatory kind of things? So let us try to see. Suppose I have an inverter, okay? And if, let us assume input is changing like this. Yeah, for example, I'm considering the analog signal, just to understand. Otherwise we can have a digital, no problem. Okay, so let us assume this kind of input I have provided. So I'm assuming that because I have an inverter, so I will get the output something like this. This will be the output. Now, what happens if I connect two inverters back to back? Then what will happen? Input will be like this and output will also be like this with some delay. So input and output will be same. Okay, but if I have to oscillate, then what I have to do? I have to connect the output of input, because oscillation means what? Once you have provided the input, okay, once you have enabled, then you don't need to apply the external input. Once you have activated the circuit, then it should oscillate automatically. Okay, so it should oscillate automatically. What it means? It means that if somehow you are able to connect the output of the circuit with the input, then how it could be done? So let us try to see here. If here we have zero, then I will get logic one. Then output of the second inverter will be logic zero. Here I will get logic one. Okay. But because if I connect the second inverter output with the input, then what will happen? I have provided initially, I have initiated with zero. Then the output of the first inverter is one, output of the second inverter is zero, then zero is again bypassed to this one. So it will hold the same state. It will latch on a particular logic. It is not going to oscillate. So to make the oscillation, we have to use odd number of inverters. Okay. So we need to have an odd number of inverters so that, because if I have provided logic zero over here, then the output of the first inverter will be one, output of the second inverter will be zero, output of third inverter will be one, then this output of the third inverter that will be connected to the input of the first inverter. So this state will change to one, this state will change to zero, one, this will become zero, and then it will again do something like this. So we are getting 0 1 0 1 0 1. So what it means, this circuit, this output will be oscillating between 0 and 1. And this is how the ring oscillator works. And this is the simple concept of the ring oscillator. Now the question is, I just told you, to make the oscillator, we must have an odd number of inverter between input and output. So this is first key point that you should know.
Sir? Second,
yes, please.
Sir, why it won't work in 2K, even number of inverter?
Inverter. Okay, let me explain again. Suppose I have a two inverter which I have connected back to back. Okay, so if I am providing input zero, in that case the output of the first inverter is one. Okay, and the output of second inverter will become zero. If let us assume I have connected the output of the second inverter with the input. Okay, so the input, because I have provided input zero, then I am getting one. After this first inverter, then the second inverter will give you logic zero, and that is connected with the input. What it means, this zero is again transferred to the input, means on the next cycle I will get zero, this will give one, this will zero, then again this zero will be connected, like this will maintain the same logic. Means what it means, this hold the logic, it is not changing its state. So this node and this node, these are fixed, like logic zero and logic one. Okay, so there is no change in the logic, there is no change in the state, so it is not oscillating. We are not getting two different logic, we are always getting logic, a single logic. What it means, this circuit will act as a latch only. Okay, so it is it will latch particular logic, it is not oscillating, so we cannot use the odd number, even number of inverters. You got the answer?
Yes, sir.
Okay, so this is one thing. Now the important thing is, like, we got to know, like, we cannot use even number of inverters to make the oscillator, we have to use the odd number of inverter. Now the question is, what is the minimum number of inverter that we can use to make the oscillator? Okay, so if you talk about the odd numbers, we can have like 1, 3, 5, 7 and so on. Okay, we just made this oscillator with three inverter, but as I told you, it can be made with the odd number of inverters. So if, because this, if I will use three inverters, in that case I need to use like six number of transistors we need at least. Okay, because for each inverter I have to use three two transistors, so total number of transistors will be six. Okay, can we make an oscillator with one inverter? Is it possible to make it? Because if I want to reduce the area of oscillator, so the one possibility, simple possibility, is like reduce the number of states. And if I am reducing the number of states, so next possible stage is one, or higher stage is five, because we have already designed the oscillator with three inverter. So the possibility could be like make the inverter, make the oscillator with one, or make the oscillator with five. But is it really possible to make any oscillator with one inverter? So let us try to validate it, whether we are able to make the oscillator with single inverter, it is possible or not. Okay, so let us try to check it. So because I am using a single inverter, so let us try to expand in this transistor level, at the transistor level. Okay, so I have, this is the simple inverter. Okay, here I have the VDD, I have some V input here, and I am giving some V output. Now the question is, like, to make the oscillator, I have to connect the output with the input. Okay, so this output must be connected with the input. So this is what I have done it. Okay, if I will do like this, okay, now if you see here this PMOS and NMOS transistors, now they are not acting as a transistor, they are now acting as a diode connected kind of structure. So because here gate to source voltage are connected to at the same level, gate to drain voltages, so gate and drain are connected at the same voltages. So these two, both the transistor will act as a diode connected kind of structure, diode kind of structure. So this will not give you the proper logic swing, it will give you just like a voltage divider circuit. Okay, so they will act as a voltage divider circuit. So the single transistor based ring, a single inverter based ring oscillator is not possible. Okay, so the minimum number of stages that we can use to design the ring oscillator is three. Okay, so three is the minimum number at which we can decide. Okay, and based on the requirement, frequency requirement, we need to adjust the sizing, we need to increase the stages. So the number of stages are completely depends on what kind of oscillation frequency we want, and all these things, right? So this is what, how we decided. So yeah, this is the basic concept of the oscillator and how we can design an oscillator based on the inverters, CMOS inverters. So three points that need to be considered. The first point is, if we are designing the oscillator, so the number of stages must be odd numbers. It should not be the even number. Okay. Second point is, like, odd number will not give you the, it will act as a latch. Okay. And the third and important thing is, like, we cannot make a single stage, like with the help of single inverter, we cannot make the ring oscillator. It will simply act as a voltage divider. Okay. So the minimum stages are three. Okay. And the fourth important point is like the number of stages that decides what should be the oscillating frequency. So to understand this point, what I'm saying at the last, let us try to go into more detail of ring oscillator. Okay. So I need to clear this one. Fine. I just told you we can make the inverter with the ring oscillator with the help of inverter. Fine. So suppose I have a one inverter, two inverter, three, four, and five. Okay. So let us assume I have a five inverter and I have connected the output of this inverter with the input of output of last inverter with the input of the first inverter. So definitely this particular arrangement will act as a ring oscillator. Okay. Now let us try to analyze this one, this particular circuit. Okay. So here we can have like the output of the first inverter is V1, V2, V3, V4, V5, and V5 and V out is the same. Okay. Why we are considering it V out? Because that will be connected with the V input. Yeah. So here we have. Now let us try to understand. Yeah. So if you see the inside this one, this is nothing but the, we can use the inverter circuit here. Okay. Now let us try to analyze this one. Suppose the input is changing from 0 to 1. In that case, let us assume the output of this first inverter is something like this. Okay. We are making the oscillators. Okay. So let us assume the output of first inverter is changing from initially it is 0 and 1, 0, 1, 0, and so on. Okay. Now, what will happen if you see the output of this second inverter, which is the V2, that will be the complement. This is the inverted version of the V1. Okay. So the inverted version of V1 with certain delay. Let us assume the delay of this one is like T1. This is T2. The inverter of delay of this is T3, T4, and T5. So I will get the output like this. Okay. But with some delay. Okay. So there will be some delay between input and output, like 50% of this one and the 50% of this one, that will give some delay. Okay. So this is what we are expecting. But if we consider only the odd number of outputs, in that case, the V1 will look like this. The V2 will also follow the same kind of pattern with certain delay. And that delay is nothing but this is the addition of T2 plus T3. Okay, so the delay between the V1 and V3 is nothing but, if you see here, this delay is nothing but this is the addition of T2 plus T3. Okay, so the based on this T2 and T3, that will be decided how much shift there will be between V1 and V3. Similarly, if we talk about the V5, so the delay between this one and the this one is nothing but this is T2 plus T3 plus T4 plus T5. So all these components will be added. T2, T3, T4 plus T5. Okay. So the total delay will be T2, T3, T4, T5. Now, the important point of consideration here is if I was receiving the V1, let us assume at time T. So the same kind of output I will receive after T2 plus T3 time. Okay. And again, the same kind of output I will receive after T2 plus T3 plus T4 plus T5 time. Okay. So the delay will be added at each stages. And this is how it looks like. So because at after each stages, the two delay component are adding here. Like initially there was T2 plus T3. But the second output, what the same output I am getting after four delay component. Okay. So the first output I was getting, the first same kind of output I was getting after T2 plus T3, where we have a two component, but now we need to have a four component, four inverters are involved in this one. Okay. So what it means, as we increase the number of stages, two components are very important and they are playing important role in that one. Okay. And how many stages are there? That also decides. So 2 into the stages. And so this is how we can calculate the total time period. And simply, if I want to calculate the frequency, this frequency will be like 1 upon t. Okay. So the time t is nothing but this is decided by 2n into tp, where tp is the delay of individual inverter. Okay. So the total oscillation frequency that is decided by 1 by t. What it means? It means that if we are increasing the number of stages, okay, in that case t will increase, then the oscillation frequency will be reduced. Okay, so the maximum frequency that can be achieved if the number of stages are less. Okay, so if the number of stages are less, then you can achieve highest frequency. But the important thing is, like, if you have to maintain the stability and other things, so the minimum number of stages you need to optimize. It's not necessary that the 3-stage inverter will give you the stable. This is not in scope of this course. So I'm not going into more detail how we can decide the other stability and other things.
Sir.
Yeah, please.
Sir, the frequency depends on time period, not on delay, right?
But the total time period, see here. If you see, because this output is connected with the next input after this much of time period, like T2 plus T3 plus T5, right? So initially I have given the input, okay? Then the second time this input of the first inverter will be triggered after delay of all these components T1 to T5, okay? So that delay play an important role. What will be the second shot or second trigger to the first inverter? Okay, so the delay play an important role when this is going to be oscillate. You got the thing?
Yes, so that will be frequency of oscillation.
Yeah, so frequency of oscillation. Okay, so this frequency of oscillation is a function of number of stages. And if I have increased the number of stages, and based on that V5 will be transferred to the input of the first inverter. Okay, and accordingly, you can decide. Okay, so this is the important thing to note. Okay, so this is how the ring oscillator works. You may have heard about the VCO, voltage controlled oscillator, right? If you see here, the oscillation frequency is controlled with the help of the number of stages only. Here in this case, let us assume all the inverters are identical. Okay, if all the inverters are identical, in that case the frequency of oscillation, like if all the inverters are identical, what it means, the delay of each individual inverter will be same, ideally. And now the number of stages will decide what will be the frequency of oscillation. But if you want to control, even though without changing the number of stages, you want to control the oscillation frequency, in that case, you have to change this inverter. You have to make this inverter voltage controlled. Okay. So, because this is not in our scope, so I'm not going into more detail, but let me explain what kind of arrangement can be made. Okay. So, for your understanding, suppose here I have a V in, here I have the VDD, and if I add one more transistor over here, and this is, let us assume, VX input is here, and here I'm connecting the V output. Now, the output of this inverter is not only depends on the input, but it also depends on this VX. So this VX, the controllability of this VX can decide what will be the frequency of oscillation. Okay, so this is what how we can make this ring oscillator as a voltage controlled oscillator. Okay, so this can be replaced, this inverter can be replaced with this one. Now this VX can becomes one controlling parameter that will decide the frequency of oscillation. Okay, so this is the thing which we should know. Okay, for VCO, we can have this kind of arrangement. Okay, so this is all about the ring oscillator, and this is the part of a stable multivibrator. Okay, Now, let us discuss few things. So this is all about this one. Now, further to this, to discuss, frequency oscillation, right? So that would be great. Now let us try to let us go to some off track, like Mach-based lenses. How we can make the Mach-based? Yeah, this is the last slide and I will finish this lecture. Okay, so the Mach-based lenses, how we can make the Mach-based lenses? Let us try to check one by one. Suppose I have a multiplexer, something like this, two input, 2:1 multiplexer, where we have a control signal. And then we have a two input, but what we have done, we have connected the output of this multiplexer with one of the input. Okay, so now let us try to see here what is happening. If clock is equal to zero, in that case, this I0 will be selected. Okay, this I0 will be selected, and because we have connected this I0 with the output, what it means, this Qn plus 1 is nothing but this is same as the Qn. So if clock is equal to 0, in that case, because the output is connected with the input, so on the next stage, I will get the same output, means Qn plus 1 is same as the Qn. What it means, this is on the latch mode. This is latching the data. Whatever the data we have, this hold the same value. But what happens if we have clock is equal to 1. If clock is equal to 1, this I1 will be selected, and whatever the input D will be there, that will be transferred. So we call it a transparent mode. So before, we have studied, there are two modes in the latches. The first mode is the latch mode or the hold mode, and the second mode is the transparent mode. So here, if you see, if I am providing clock is equal to 1, in that case, whatever the input D we have, that D, like means Qn plus 1 is nothing but this is equal to D. Okay, so the Qn plus 1 is D if clock is equal to 1, and Qn plus 1 is equal to Qn if clock is equal to 0. So this is how we can make the multiplexer based latch. Okay, other alternative could also be there, right? So other kind of possibility could be there. This kind of arrangement, we can connect this output with the I1 as well, but here we have made like the bubbled clock. Okay, so active low clock is here. Yes,
sir, can we continue in another class? We have Viva now.
Okay, so I will finish in 2 minutes only, then it will be finished. I will take 2 minutes. Okay, right? Okay, so yeah, simply if you see here, if K is, yeah, simply here, like I have placed here, clock is bubbled, clock is here. So if clock is equal to 0, so in that case, that will give 1 after this bubble. So what means, I1 will be selected. And similarly, if clock is equal to 1, then here it will give 0. So I0 will be selected. Okay. So based on that, we can decide the transparent in the latch mode. So this is quite simple. That is why I'm going quickly. So the expression is just like what we wrote here, clock complement dot Qn plus clock dot Q, which is the Qn plus 1. And similarly, the other arrangement could be something like this. If I have made, make the complement of it, like using the positive clock, and I have connected the output with the input I1, then we will get the opposite expression. Okay. And similarly for this one. So we have all four combinations. Just quickly, you can go through it, and it is very easy to understand how it is working. So Qn plus 1, the expression will be like Q bar into D. Here initially the expression was clock bar dot Qn plus clock D. Here the clock bar D and clock Qn. Okay, so here we have a two different things. So because of this both opposite kind of arrangement, we call the first two latches as the positive latch, because the transparent mode comes when clock is equal to 1. And the second, third and fourth kind of structure, we call them the negative latches, because transparent mode comes when the clock is equal to 0. Okay, so this is all about the multiplexer based latches. And this is quite easy. Like if you are able to understand the first circuit, all other circuits are like same, only some different arrangement is there. Rest other things are same. Okay, So this is all about the sequential logic circuit. Okay. So in the next class, we will talk about the memory.